said glory to God. Are y'all excited to be here tonight? I don't know about you, but I came to receive. Oh, I came to receive tonight. So I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, I'm ready to receive. Hallelujah. Come on now and lift your hands to heaven and give him glory and worship. Oh, Jesus, we magnify you, Lord. Oh, come on, lift your hands to him and worship. Yes, we worship you, Lord.
I didn't practice this with them. So if we don't get it, it's not their fault. Just grab three parts, because I hear this little song going around me that we've sung since we were kids.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
just take our hands and lift them up and worship Jesus here for a second. Jesus, we magnify you. Jesus. Jesus, come on, lift up your voice and magnify that name. That name. Jesus. I'm singing that name, Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus.
Kings and kingdoms.
great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Jesus, we lift up your hands. We lift up our hands and we magnify you. We magnify your name. We give you praise, Lord Jesus. Jesus.
So good to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Go ahead and be seated this evening. Thank you, everyone who's joined us by live stream, and those of you who are watching. We ask that those of you in here, make sure you silence your phones and electronic devices. And we'll have service tomorrow, 10 a.m., 7 p.m. We will have childcare in the evenings for everyone ages 0 to 5, all children in the mornings for ministers 0 to 3. And we want to let you know you can order the CD and DVD sets of this if you would like, this set of meetings for your archives, if you would prefer. And if you're a minister and you're here and you've registered, if you will place that order by tonight, we can have those ready for you to take home with you tomorrow. We will still have prayer school tomorrow with Pastor Noel and Pastor Ruby, as well as our worship training session. I believe we'll do an hour after the morning service, maybe for both. We did that this morning. We changed prayer school up. We normally say 1 p.m., but we will do prayer school an hour, same time as worship training session. And then we will have tomorrow night, it will be our double up offering night and ministry to the sick as well. If you are here and you came for that, we've got some upcoming meetings. Paducah, Kentucky, May 5th through the 9th. That is our next Miracle Crusade. And then Ontario, Canada, August 25th through the 29th. And another location will be announced October 6th through the 10th. We're working on another location. We've got something in mind. And then camp meeting June 3rd through the 7th with Pastor Nancy Dufresne and Dr. Bill Winston. And our ladies' conference, October 1st through the 3rd. And then our ministers' conference, first annual, maybe? Ministers Conference is going to be November 5th through the 7th. All ministers, if you're watching, if you're here, must apply on our website. Current and active FOF members are pre-approved to attend, but go ahead and fill out an application. That's going to help with registration. But if you are not part of FOF and you want to come, come on. This is a closed meeting, so you will need to register for it and fill out online. You can't just call. We will need some information about your ministry and what you do, and we are just going to be very specific about those that Pastor Nancy wants to attend this meeting. And then we will have, so everybody at each of these meetings that is not a closed meeting like the ministers conference, make sure you register if you're coming. We wanted to let you know that we are coming very close to the end of our Bible school year. We do not have very many weeks left for World Harvest Bible Training Center this year, closing it out. Pastor Nancy, she's going to be our graduation commencement speaker in May. But we're already preparing for next year Bible school. We've already got applications coming in, seems like on a regular basis. We're getting those signed off on. We're reviewing them. So it's time to make plans that if you are interested in World Harvest Bible Training Center, now is the time you want to start looking into attending. Don't wait till last minute and then you get desperate to not miss the leading of God. You want to do it now. If there's any kind of leading, any kind of prompting on the inside, or even just something you can say, I've got to check this out. I'm interested. We've got some information out in our foyer. And you can talk to any of our staff members. We'd be glad to answer any questions. It is a full-time school, Monday through Thursday, 8:30 to 11:30. You can be trained in serving in your local church, trained in ministry. There's an optional third-year internship, but registration is 50% off if you get it in before July 15th. And our start date is September 3rd for the Bible school. So time passes by very quickly when you're having fun. So if you're enjoying this week, just know time is going by quickly and you need to make haste and go out and get information, inquire, get online. We've got a separate, I know they have an Instagram page just for the Bible school where you can kind of get a glimpse of the different instructors that come and the times that they have. It's a catching school. We do not do any kind of online school or correspondence school. That is not the vision that God gave Pastor Nancy and Dr. Dufresne. It's something you have to come here and catch. You will miss the entire spirit of the whole thing if we were to let you stay home, because it's not proper training. And proper impartations. To receive an impartation, you must be seen and in the vicinity to have that deposited into your spirit. And to get to the next place, to the next thing, you need those impartations. So that's why we call it a catching school. You receive impartations from each of the ministers that come through the preaching and teaching, through times of prayer, in the Holy Ghost, through times of the Spirit of God just moving and pouring himself out on the students. So you can't catch those and get those impartations by sitting at home and just doing pen and paper and book. So that's an emphasis here, which is good if you're coming. If you're going to be here, just know it's more than pen and paper tests and submitting, you know, and showing us what a great student you are. With the books, we're not as much interested as that, as how hungry you come here And you bring that hunger and you draw everything that God has for you. We're interested in your hunger for the things of God and to fulfill the plan of God for your life and to help. If it is to go back and help your pastor and help your local church, we can help you with that. Amen. And Pastor Nancy out there, she's got a few books. If you're new around here and you don't know her materials, this one is The Price of the Double Portion Anointing. This especially is for those in full-time ministry, but anyone with any who stepped into anything in their life, whether it be your mother, your a business owner, you're a teacher, you're work for as an employee, and you're looking to make progress in your life, and you want to advance and grow in the anointing that's on you for what God has. You just say, I want to grow in serving, and the anointing that I have as a greeter or an usher, this is for you. Jesus appeared to her when she was in Russia, or came. She didn't see him, but he had her to pen much of what's in this book and gave her the outline and the instruction of how to grow in the anointing on your life. It does not come just because you work real hard or because, you know, you're in the right place at the right time. There's qualifications to that, not just because you asked for it either. So she lays some of these things out to help us in growing and developing in that anointing. And this one, Victory Over Grief and Sorrow. Praise the Lord for this book. It's our most loved book, and it's one that people have so misunderstood, the revelation that has come out of this book, and that you can have victory in any circumstance that would bring sorrow to your life, disappointment, frustration, anything that you feel like you missed, you lost out on, it's too late, and you're lamenting, there's sorrow with that. You gotta let that go. And she helps us say, well, that's easier said than done. Well, she says it and she helps us to get it done. Makes it very easy in the word. She doesn't just give her story and everybody go, oh, that's nice for you. She shows in the word of God how to walk out victory over any sorrowful situation, any situation that would cause grief to come over you. You can get through that on the other side, victorious every single time. No, not living with any remnant of difficulty. So if you haven't heard of this book, we actually encourage our people, keep a copy on hand because situations are gonna come up. Keep a copy to give to somebody. Hand out, this is a great witnessing tool. Amen, so that book is out there. And then this one, God, the Revealer of Secrets. Revealer of Secrets, how to know the will of God for your life. You heard Pastor Noel so wonderfully teach this morning how he persevered in finding out the will of God. He didn't have this book. He only had his bathroom. But he made it. But because of Pastor Nancy's teaching and the revelation, we don't have to sit on the toilet every morning. We can take the steps to find out and know the will of God, but you have to have the same hunger and the same fervency. That's what he demonstrated, was the hunger and the relentlessness. I'm not going any further without the will of God. We should all be that way. So this book is for everyone. You say, well, I feel like I'm already in the will of God. It's ever moving. He's always moving. He's always, yes, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, but his will, he's got things for us to do and places for us to go, people for you to talk to, and you've got to know the will for his will for your life. Amen. So those books are out there. And then this one, Your Authority in Prayer. It's an audio teaching. So if you like audio teachings, that one is out there. You can purchase that. Time for the offering, Pastor Craig.
Hallelujah. 1 Kings chapter 17. I'm sorry it's not 2 Kings chapter 4, but I won't touch that one. That belongs to somebody else. 1 Kings chapter 17. What a privilege it is to receive the expense offering. What a privilege it is to sow. Hallelujah. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew or rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that you'll drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called her and said, Bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand. She said, As the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat it and die. Wow, she's in a bad place. And Elijah said unto her, Fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me therefore a little cake first. And bring it unto me, and after make for thee and thy son. For watch not. And he tells her what's going to happen before. He prophesies to her miracle before she actually obeys. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, The barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days, and the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. You know, years ago when we first hooked up with Dr. Dufresne and Pastor Nancy, the Lord dealt with me about this passage of scripture, and I still meditate on it all these years later. And you know, I won't give the whole story, but my wife and I were going to be missionaries. We just have a heart for Spanish people, and we decided to go to Peru and leave everything in Canada and go and be missionaries there. And so we did language school training and raised all the money, and we were on our way in Peru, actually. Dr. Dufresne, who I love, but he didn't know me, but he had come to the church. My pastor had invited him many times, and I'd sat in his services and been so blessed. And so he happened to be ministering in the church that we just decided to go to his meetings while we were down there preparing for our move. And he called me out, prophesied, didn't know me, didn't know anything about me, and said, he talked to me about a church that I would have. Then he said, Are you a pastor? And I said, No. And he kind of looked at me, and he said, Are you planning on being a pastor? And I said, No. And he said, Well, I don't know what this means then, but he gave that prophecy, because I was resisting and fighting against the plan of God. I didn't want to live in Canada. I didn't want to be a pastor, and God forbid I start a church from scratch. I mean, there's just no way. And yet he saw that in the spirit in the nation that I was trying to run away to. I mean, talk about the mastery of God. But I fought my wife, and she fought me, and she said, I'm not going, because she got it in the spirit. And I said, We are going. And she said, No, we're not. And so it took me a while to pray and for God to say, Listen to your wife. She's right. It's the greatest revelation I've ever got, ever in my life. I'm getting to a point. The Lord said to me 3 months after, when we decided not to go and to obey the plan of God and the vision the doctor had seen, which I knew was a confirmation. I was just fighting against it. But the Lord said to me, He said, If you had done your own thing and gone to that nation, even though you may have had some measure of success, He said, you would have wound up on the ash heap of ministry. That's how He said it to me. An ash heap, meaning it's burned to nothing and there's ashes only. He took me to this verse, and He said, that widow woman was gathering sticks to die. She had nothing. She was going nowhere. But there was a divine rescue that God planned for her. God sent a prophet to her town. It's an amazing thing. She had nothing, and she was going nowhere, kind of like me. And yet God sent a prophet to her. And notice how the ravens didn't argue because they're animals. But the lady didn't seem to know nothing about what God so commanded her. And you've heard pastors say, I'm not saying something that's brand new, but it took the prophet of God, that office, getting around that lady, for her to recognize and cooperate with what God had already commanded her to do, but what she wasn't really understanding properly. In other words, he drew out of her the plan of God and revealed to her her role. And I'm telling you, when I got hooked up with the Dufresne, see, it's a divine connection in that prophet's office. The biggest blessing, I think, to me is that they helped me to understand what God had called me to do, where I was supposed to fit, where I was supposed to go. And the amazing thing is that woman not only found out the plan of God for her life, which the divine connection will do, but that woman brought a supply to the prophet. Did you notice the prophet needed a supply? And in the process, the woman got her miracle. Isn't that amazing? When there is a divine connection, what's inside of you will be drawn out. And you'll get revelation on where you fit, what your job is in the body of Christ. You can't get that properly without that divine connection. That alone is worth everything. It's worth it. But did you notice that woman had a supply? And when we take offerings, it is our chance to bring a supply first. First. Then did you notice that she got a supply? She got an answer to her great need. And her life was saved. Her family was saved. Her son was saved. You know, when you hook up and you bring what's first to the right place, not only do you realize what's inside you and what you're called to do, but you also get a miracle out of it. And at the same time, this is the mastery of God, at the same time supply the prophet's needs, but also get a miracle for yourself. Praise God. Can I just read a little bit more of that? Okay, I just want to bring out one more point. Since Pastor Debbie, you know, always talks about the other guy, I just want to draw attention to this guy. Look at verse 17. And it came to pass after these things that the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, fell sick. Kind of the same as the Shunammite woman, right? And his sickness was so sore that there was no breath left in him. And she said to Elijah, what have I to do with thee, O thou man of God? Are you come to call my sin to remembrance? Same as, of course, he didn't slay nothing, neither did God, but she just didn't understand. And he said to her, give me thy son. Did you notice the prophet didn't shy away? Because of the divine connection, he knew he had a supply for that lady. We are that lady. We are that lady. Give me thy son. And he took him out of her bosom. She's holding him tight. Now watch now, and carried him up into a loft. See, the other one tells, the Shunammite story tells how the woman said, I perceive, and she built. But this lady did the same thing. We just don't get all those details. She built a chamber for the prophet. There was a parallel between Elijah and this woman from Zarephath, and Elisha and the woman, the Shunammite woman. And he took him out of her bosom and carried him up into the loft where he abode. He lived there. And laid him upon his own bed. And he cried to the Lord and said, Lord, thou hast brought evil upon this one. And he stretched himself. You know the story. I don't have to read all the verses. And verse 22, and the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came again, and he revived. Elijah took the child, brought him down. Can you imagine that moment? Woo, down out of the chamber into the house, and delivered him to the mother, and said, see, thy son liveth. Let me tell you something. When the chips are down and there's big issues, you want the divine connection that God connected you with. There's been many times where not everybody has a one-on-one access, and that's okay. You don't technically need that. There's been many times I've come with big issues, and I'll sit in that seat, and I'll say, Father, I have come to the house of the prophet. But let me tell you something. Did you notice that lady, after the famine was over, after the miracle, everything's fine now, but what did she do? That prophet stayed in proximity. She made sure the man of God was close. And this is where I think a lot of people miss it. They don't have the proximity that they should have. They don't make the effort and make the sacrifice to keep close to that person that God has connected them, because closeness and proximity matters when you need an impartation. And I can't tell you, and even in these meetings, even tonight, I would encourage you, sit in that chair and say to the Lord, Father, you've divinely connected me to this house. I am in proximity to this ministry and to this office that you've divinely connected me to. I put a demand. That woman put a demand on that office and she got an answer. You can put a demand no matter what you're going through, even if Pastor Nancy doesn't know anything what you're going through. The Holy Ghost knows. And you can say, Lord, I put a demand to get answers, to get clarity. It may not be a thus saith the Lord prophecy call you out, but something can be said, or maybe something is not said. Listen. Many times, nothing is said about what I'm going through, but because I'm around the person with a grace for my life. Just sitting in that building around the person with a grace, answers will drop inside of me. Answers will come inside of me because I'm in proximity. And answers can come because I put a demand on that. I leave that hotel and I say, Father, I'm putting a demand on that office. And Lord, whether nothing is preached about what I need or whether it is, I expect answers. I expect victories. I expect impartations. When the chips are down, the man of God, in this case, the woman of God, is there for me. But if you just kind of show up, whatever, yeah, this is nice. There's got to be, I put a demand on that. And I stay in proximity to that. And so I tell you, this has served me well over the years. The Lord said, stay in proximity. That's where you'll get more if you stay in proximity. If you show up and then put a demand on it in the services, you'll get more. But isn't it wonderful that what is in us is drawn out by being around that divine supply? Clarity comes when we're around that divine supply. And we get the privilege of supplying that need while at the same time getting a miracle for ourselves. We have a chance today to supply the need. Hallelujah. And we're believing for double whatever the expenses are this week. And we will have it because we have the most generous people in the world sitting in this room right now. And if you're watching, you're part of that great generous crowd. So this is your opportunity. Don't just watch and don't participate. Be a part of this. Click the donate button. Do what you need to do to say, I, even though I'm not there, but I'm still putting a demand on the supply. Hallelujah. Praise God. Isn't that wonderful? Sometimes, Pastor, I wonder if Elisha didn't hear these stories from his father about the woman. Because it's amazing the mirror parallel with the Shunammite woman. You just gotta wonder. I mean, it's just this, and both had their sons raised from the dead. Both had miracles, and notice both had proximity. Both put a demand. Both bought a supply. This is a spiritual law, brother and sister, and it works. Thank God we are divinely connected. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of the divine connection. Being around the ones with the grace for our life. Thank you that we can sit and know that because we're here, that anointing will bring answers. It will bring clarity. It will draw out of us. Revelation will come to us about our future, about what we're called, about your assignment for our lives. And we will know. We will see and we will know. And at the same time, we will bring a supply and receive a miracle. We thank you for the tremendous revelation of the divine connection. And Lord, I thank you for those watching and those present. Lord, if they feel in their heart a connection to this ministry, to the Dufresne family, specifically Pastor Nancy, I thank you, Lord, they'll put a demand on that. They'll get as close to it as possible. They'll maintain proximity. And Father, they will be a supply and receive a miracle. We bring our supply tonight in this offering, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' precious name, and everybody said amen. You know the ways to give. Thank you for giving tonight. God bless you. Are you thankful? I am.
chorus one more time. You will.
we glorify you. No other name is worthy. No other name is worthy. No other name is worthy. No other name is equal. We thank you, Father, that that name belongs to us. We're in that name. That name is ours. And we thank you for it. We thank you for it. We thank you for it. We glorify. We magnify. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Mastikiye, mostototoye, mastakaye, mastikiye. You know, I was blessed by what Pastor Craig shared because it is pertinent to every one of us.
Amen.
Pertinent to every one of us, and many, many do not understand the importance of what he was talking about. And I'm going to tag on some to what he said, and it has nothing to do with in connection with this ministry that I'm saying it. I'm saying it because it's a truth we all have to walk in. Many think that they're connected just because they know where they're supposed to be connected. That's not connection. I mean, you know, in 25 years of pastoring, there would be times that I would be out, and other pastors no doubt have run into this. You're out maybe at the grocery store or restaurant. Somebody comes up to you and says, oh, this is my pastor. And I go, wow, I don't know you.
Yeah.
Hello.
Right.
But they think just because they know that you should be their pastor, they think they have a pastor, and they don't have a pastor, and that's the danger. They think they have one. It would be like with a car, and I don't know about today's builds on cars, but the ones we grew up with. Spark plugs, all the different things. You can't just, a car builder can't just take all the things that belong under the hood and just drop them in the hood. They have to be rightly connected, not just present. Not just present. Because you can have all the components, but if one isn't connected right, none of the other components are effective as they should be. And things may look like they're moving and will work, but you get partway down the road and then it's felt that something's out of place. It's not enough to know where we're connected, to be connected and say that's connection. That's not connection. And I say this for congregation members toward their pastors. I say it for whoever God has connected you to. I'm not talking about me in this ministry. I'm talking about a truth that is so important. And that's one of the things that Jesus said to me that night in St. Petersburg, Russia, with the double portion anointing visitation. He said, you will have to be rightly connected and stay connected.
Yes.
To your divine supply, or you will not fulfill all. I've had two times now that God has sent me to churches, and he sent me for the reason he said, because these pastors, and on both times, he said they won't finish their course. One, he said, will die prematurely unless they get rightly connected. And it matters that we're sensitive to that. And we don't just give a token appearance or a token phrase and say, you're a voice in my life. There has to be evidence.
Evidence.
Amen.
And as he said, proximity, yes. Proximity, yes. Proximity. It's so important that we don't think that social media is the proximity God's referring to. Listen, thank God for social media in the sense of things you can receive when people can't be there. But what happens is people get they take a substitute for proper connection and think that it's just because, you know, just because you can. A great benefit today is a lot of people can work from home.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, for mamas and stuff, that they can still be with their babies and work from home and stuff, that's great. That works with a natural profession sometimes, but it didn't work in the laws of the Spirit. It's not, you can't call it functioning the same. So just be sober, be sober. Don't be duped by thinking, I know where I'm supposed to be, I listen, I watch. That is not always equal proper connection. Be aware. And I'm talking to congregation members regarding their pastors. I'm talking to ministers regarding whoever God connects them to. So we need to be sober about it. We need to be sober because some things it's life and death. It's life and death. And it matters. And if you're going to stay rightly connected, you can never measure convenience. And you can never let money decide how close your proximity is, because there is always demands on our money. And your demand that money is to serve your connection first. And that's what the prophet was saying to the widow woman. He said, make your cake. Then he said, bring it to me. He didn't say, make mine. Excuse me. He said, make my cake, bring it to me. He didn't say, make mine, then make one for you and your son. He said, make one for me, bring it to me. Then go back and make for you. Why? Because you'll be so tempted to start sharing what you haven't yet presented. And when you're starving, you could say, I'll just take half of his. You made his and bring it so you don't touch into it. Dog ear income and say, this is for my connection. I'm not talking about offerings, just I'm talking about to get there, the expenses, the cost, getting there. Because your money is first and foremost for the plan of God. First and foremost. It's not first and foremost for your mortgage. It's first and foremost for the plan of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Pastor Craig, thank you. That was rich. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, turn around to somebody before you're seated. Give them a great big God bless you tonight. Hallelujah. We're going to endeavor to kind of pick up where we were last night. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, the King James translation. God is speaking and he says, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. So he's saying, never let your sin of the past stop you from coming. Because you're clean. You're clean. Verse 19, if you be willing and obedient. If I could say this, if you'll be willing and obedient to come. If you'll be willing and obedient to come and let us reason together. If you'll be willing and obedient to do that, you'll eat the good of the land. Why? Because in the coming, you'll not just be heard, you will hear. Verse 20, but if you refuse what? If you refuse to come and let us reason together, you shall be devoured with a sword. And that's not God sentencing people to that. That is God letting us know without coming, something's against you.
Yes.
And what's against you can gain advantage if you don't come and listen to what I know about your situation. And in reading the Living Bible, the first phrase, verse 18, says, come, let's talk this over. And we spent some time last night referring to that because God invites us to come and talk things over.
Amen.
So you can be heard, but also so he can be heard.
Amen.
Amen. Because hearing him changes the outcome.
Amen.
If you act on what you hear.
Right.
Amen. If you act on what you hear. We have to learn to agree with what we hear, regardless of what we would have thought should be done. It's dangerous to hear and decide not to. Dangerous to hear and decide not to. Let me jump around here a minute. I was in one setting talking to a family years ago, my husband and I, and go with me. Let's go to Exodus chapter 25, Exodus chapter 25. And I want us to start in verse 8, and this is the Amplified Classic Translation, so if you have a device, you can pull that up. You may want to do that. Exodus chapter 25 and verse 8. Moses was receiving from God instruction of how to build the tabernacle. And he said, Exodus 25, verse 8, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Talking about the Hebrews delivered out of Egypt. And you shall make it according to all that I show you. Look at this. All that I show you. All that I show you. Don't leave out something is what he's saying. Make it according to all that I show you. The pattern of the tabernacle or dwelling and the pattern of all the furniture of it. Verse 40 of Exodus 25. Just flip down, look down. And it says, and see to it. God is still talking to him about this building of the tabernacle. And see to it that you copy exactly their pattern which was shown. Look at this. Shown you on the mountain. Shown you on the mountain. What's he talking about? Shown you in the presence of God. When you were in the presence of God and you heard and you saw, go out and replicate that. Follow that. Because when you're in the presence of God, it's easy to agree.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
When you first hear and God speaks to you about something, it's easy to agree. But then when you leave the place of revelation, and now you're just carrying the revelation, you're not carrying the feeling of the revelation. You might not sense that presence. God still expects you. You do it exactly as was shown you on the mount. In the presence of God, regardless of whether you sense me or not, whatever he said to you.
Yeah.
My husband and I were talking years ago to a couple, and we had asked them about someone close to them. And how are they doing? Not doing so well. Well, why? Well, you know, our son was considering marrying someone. And at one point of worshiping God, just on his own, God spoke and says, don't marry that one. And they came in to the parent and said, God just said this to me. And so they went to the fiance and said, I can't do it. But see, the fiance didn't hear that. You can't go, you can't be influenced by people who didn't hear what you heard on the mountain.
That is right.
You cannot factor in their voice. Even if you love them. Even if they love you. You cannot take in the voice of someone who God didn't speak to on the mount.
That's good. Yeah.
Because when Moses came off that mount, God said, see to it that you do it exactly as it was shown you on the mount. Why? Because you're going to come down among 3 million people who have opinions. And options. When you hear, you cannot take counsel from those who did not hear what you heard.
Yeah, that's good. Amen.
And if you do, you get in trouble with God.
Amen.
Because he knows what you heard.
Amen.
And you have to not let even your own reasonings sway you away from what you heard just because you no longer feel his presence that you felt when you first heard it. You have to hold to that moment. And when you walk away and you don't sense his presence that way, you have to hold fast to what he said. Because your own reasonings, finances, your own circumstances can try to persuade you, and it will seem like adjusting just a little bit is no big deal. Doing something a little bit differently, it might save me more. Do it exactly as it was shown you on the mount.
Very good.
Amen.
It was critical.
Yes.
That we do this. I have talked. So that person met with their fiance, and of course the fiance wasn't on the mount with them.
Right.
Didn't hear that is what I mean. So they didn't agree. So they persuaded and they went ahead and went against what, and then it's years of heartache. And then you have children and then it's compounded. Why? Because you laid down what you heard just because you don't feel the same thing you felt when you heard it. You don't feel that anointing. You don't. And then people are wanting God to repeat himself when they get out of that place, and he doesn't have to. You're not assured of him repeating it. Because once you've heard it, he expects you to hold to it. I heard something recently, God tell me to do something. And I waited a little bit because this was a new territory for me. And it was a sobering thing. And I didn't just want to barge right into it. And I kept waiting for him to maybe confirm it and say something later, and he didn't. Right. But I went ahead and did it because it stayed with me.
Stayed.
You know, when you've heard, it stays.
Yes.
Yes. You can dismiss it if you want.
Yeah.
But if you'll stay sensitive to the Spirit, you don't dismiss it. And God never said another thing to me, and then I acted on it.
Uh-huh.
And after I did it, then he spoke to me again about that. What am I saying? If he says it once, you're not assured of twice.
No.
Amen.
And if you wait for twice before you obey, what did we read in Isaiah? The devourer.
Yes.
There's a devourer. And what happened with this young man is because he heard that, but because others who didn't hear, he gave his ear to them. They swayed him away from what he heard. It's critical that when you hear, that you hold to that regardless of what you feel. Why? Because it's the truth and no lie. It's the truth and no lie. It's the truth and no lie.
Amen.
And I've been surprised at times when people would say, God said something to me, and then they the next time I see them, they're doing the exact opposite. And I go, I'm baffled by that. That frightens me. In a reverent way. So know this, when he says, come, let us reason together, he expects what he says to be regarded. In that hearing. He expects us, he's not harsh. I'm not saying do this or else. That's not his approach. But there has to be honor for what you're hearing. That you don't just dismiss it because you don't feel something anymore. Or because no one else heard it. I know what God said to me, and I'm holding to it.
Amen.
I can't tell you, after Ed's homegoing, God would say things to me about these critical projects we had to finish. He would say things to me, and he would say it once. And I would have to hold to that thing to get me to the other side. And I was so grateful because what he said was my anchor. And I just repeated what he said over and over. I would repeat it to myself so that I wouldn't get swayed by what I saw and what I heard from out here in circumstances. Amen. Now go with me if you would. Let's go to Romans 10. You know the verse. Romans 10, verse 17. What am I saying? When you say, when he says, come, let's talk together. There has to be an approach when you come to him, is when you say something, I will regard that. I will honor that. It's, you're not talking optional words to me. They're critical. And I have found this. I have had God say things to me that to me weren't a big deal. But down the road, it was big. If God gets involved, now it's important. If he says something to you regarding a certain situation that you didn't even think needed really his input because it's just a daily type thing. But if he says something, that gives it weight, and there's something connected down the road. So don't treat it lightly, even if it seems like he's speaking to you about something you would think insignificant. Now, Romans 10, verse 17. So then, faith cometh by what?
Hearing.
Hearing. And hearing by the word of God. The written word and the spoken word, too. Both. Faith comes by hearing what God says about it. Until you hear what God says about it, you're not safe to move ahead. Because what God says about it is your answer to opposition. And when you go to move ahead, you're going to have opposition. And you better not move ahead until he has put an answer in your mouth to opposition. Does that make sense to you? Faith comes by hearing what God says. Until you've heard what God said to you about your situation, you're going to lack faith in dealing with that. You have to hear what he says. Faith comes when you hear. Hearing it settles it for you. Hearing what he says settles it for you. His written word is general and specific instruction for all of us, but sometimes we have to have more specifics. Because the word doesn't always spell out the specifics you're going to face. I was asked by, recently, I was asked by a minister and said, you know, what do you attribute to what kept you on course when your husband left? I said, one thing, hearing. Hearing. That's because when I heard, I knew exactly what steps to take. It didn't matter whether they were legal steps. It didn't matter whether it was ministry steps, financial steps. The hearing is the success of it. Amen. But then you have to stake, You have to follow exactly what you heard without adjustment, without alteration, and without your own input.
Yes. Amen.
Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4. While you're there, let me harp back here a moment to Romans 10:17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, or what God says. The word of God is what he say, what he says. It's what he says. Hearing God gives you the faith to do what he says. That's key. Hearing gives you the faith to do it. Abram heard, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. God didn't say that to Lot. Lot could not take that and do in line with that. Couldn't do it. Why? Because God didn't say that to him. That's how important hearing is. That's why you don't just adopt what God said to someone else and say, I like that. Pastors, you don't adopt how you run your church based on how God told another pastor to run his church. Don't do it. Because if God didn't say it to you, you don't have the faith for that. Well, I'm a faith person. You don't have the faith for what God didn't say. You can't barrel your way into. Years ago, Fred Price had, and I'd never read it. I just remember the title of hearing people talk about faith, foolishness, or presumption. Because people were saying what was faith and it wasn't really faith. What is presumption? Presuming to move ahead when you haven't heard. You're on dangerous territory.
Exactly.
Our safety's in hearing.
Yes.
Because what we hear, now we can have faith for. Yes. Now we can do it.
Yes.
And that's what, when that minister asked me, what do you attribute to being able to continue the way you have? One thing, hearing.
Yes.
Hearing.
Yes.
I value that.
Yes.
I value that. Yes. Proverbs 4, 7. Proverbs 4, verse 7. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all thy getting, get understanding. When it says wisdom is the principal thing, get wisdom. What God says is his wisdom. So you have to hear what he says. You got to get that. So that means hearing from God is the principal thing. You understand that? Hearing from God is the principal thing. The wisdom of God for you is the will of God for your life. What's his will for your life? That's his wisdom for you. And you better get that. So you don't float and bump and run into walls and drift from here and there and move your family from one location to the next, guessing and going. Get wisdom. Get what God authored for your life. Get it. Amen. And I'll just, for time's sake, I'll just refer to these. James chapter 1, verse 5. If any man lacks wisdom, let him.
Yes.
It doesn't say let him walk on by faith.
Right.
Faith is not meant to take the place of wisdom. Because there is no faith without hearing from God.
Amen.
And many times people are moving ahead. I'm just going ahead in faith and they haven't heard. That's not faith. That's presumption. If any man lacks wisdom, let him ask. And then James 4, 2, you have not because you. Well, I asked and I asked, asking, when we talk about it, to ask involves to hear back an answer. You can't just say, I asked, and then move on. It was so cute. I was reading. I keep a, like, in my device, I keep a list of all the cute things that my kids said growing up and my grandbabies say. And Bubby was just learning how to talk. And Bubby had the best words, the best phrases. They were all twisted and garbled. And, you know, they work your way into your family way of talking. You know, 10 years later, you're still using those words that were distorted, you know. And they were at our house, and there was evidently something that he had was on the counter, and he picked it up and just ate it. And Morgan said, did you ask? And he just kept eating. And she said, did you ask? And he didn't know what she's telling him. He didn't understand. And he keeps saying, she said, did you ask? And he said, ask. he didn't even know what is asking. He just said, ask. I think that's the way a lot of people do with God. Ask. And then walk off. You ask so you can hear. You ask so you can hear a reply. It's not saying, I talked to the pastor about it. Because so many will make a decision and then come tell the pastor what they're doing, and then they go, have you talked to your pastor? Oh, yeah, I talked to him. No, you inform. It's not counseling, it's informing. But we do that with God. Ask. And then we walk off before we've heard. Because we think that what we planned is what he's saying. You get that? When you ask, you can't go with your plan to the asking. To the asking party.
That's good.
Don't invite your plan.
That's right.
There it is.
Very good. That's good.
Because God will not trump what you've chosen. His honor won't let him. His honor won't let him. I take time to hear. Because there's so many people connected to my hearing. Right now, we have around 40 people on staff. I don't just have 40 people on staff. I have 40, not all, because sometimes I have husband and wife. 40 families.
Yes.
It's multiplied people.
It's multiplied.
Yes.
I'm aware what decisions I make are ripple effect out to every one of those. And then there's partners. Hearing is not just connected to you. Husbands, hearing is just not about, well, I'm the head of the house and I'm the head of the family and we're going to do what I want. Jesus said the husband, he likened the bride of Christ to how you treat the bride. Jesus laid down his life for the sheep. Jesus wasn't on the earth getting his way and making everybody hop to it. That's not leading a family.
No, it's not.
It's my way and hop to it, and you better serve me. Jesus did not come to be served. He came and served.
Yes.
That's right.
So husbands, you have to hear.
Yeah.
Because it affects your wife, it affects your children, it affects the testimony your children will carry through life about God.
Exactly.
Because if they get thrown from one place of problem to another because we're guessing and going without hearing, they start distrusting.
Yes.
They get turned off to God, because you've told them God said it, and it was presumption. And now they're confused and they don't want anything of it. They're tired of the difficulties. And I'm not trying to make people feel bad because we've all missed it. I'm saying we can't just keep repeating what we've done wrong. Let's back up and do it right. Every single one of us can do it right. Every single one of us can do it right and quit repeating a bad habit and calling God's involvement in on that. Here, here, here. Some think that taking time is wasting time. Taking time to hear, they think it's wasting time. It's safety. It's safety. Now, when God says something to you and you know it's God, prompt obedience. But when it is a bigger decision that involves more than you, it involves maybe a congregation or your family or a traveling ministry or partnership, it has a ripple effect. It's your safety. There's wisdom in waiting.
Yes.
To make certain. And God will not rebuke you for going at a safe pace. Amen. When God is leading me to do something, I have something in my heart. I haven't heard words necessarily. I just have a sense of something. I wait on that. I wait. I don't just jump on it the first time I sense that. Because sometimes I sense it because he's wanting me to ask him. So he can reveal more about what I'm sensing. So in taking time, more will be shown. I mean, for example, when we started the Miracle Crusades, I just had a sense that needed to happen. And I sat on that for months, not in disobedience and not in slowness, but in honor for what this is bringing in. There's a lot of expense with this. There's the partners giving with this. There's the staff time. There's a lot connected to it. And I don't flippantly just jump into something and call it skill.
That's it.
The skill is in the waiting. When it's something like this. Now, if it's just you, then God will expect prompt obedience. But when it's a big picture, you might want to take a different approach. Why? Because you're reverent about what all is impacted by this. And accuracy matters to you. Accuracy matters. When God is leading me to do something, I sense that. I will hold that up. I'm not talking about hours of prayer. No. I'll just hold it up. Mm-hmm. I'll keep an ear turned toward God about that.
Yeah.
I'm not mindless about it. I'm mindful of it.
Yeah.
And so I'll just, Father, this is in my heart, and I just keep lifting that up, and I keep lifting that up over time. And every time I lift it up, if it's God, it seems better and better. It seems to be more and more right the more I lift it up. If it's not God, it gets further and further away from rightness. It doesn't feel that rightness anymore. You can't learn that. You can't have that leading of rightness every time you think about it if you're going fast.
Right.
You have to have time to play that, hold that up, and let that sense of his will grow. It matters. It matters. Why? Because time's too short to miss and have to go back and clean up and have to try to recover some things. Amen. So the more you consider something that God's dealing with you about, if it's God, it seems more and more right. And I'm talking about not considering it just mentally. In here, you're considering it. But even so,
it will seem right in your thought life.
Yes.
But I'm talking about here. It's from, because people can mentally put their affections on something and they think, and they'll call it right. But these, some of these leadings are recognized over time, so you better give it the time to have it recognized. Being adamant is not faith. I can't tell you the number of times I've heard, oh, no, this is what, this is it, this is, and I go, oh, that's not God. You want to know why? They are so adamant they're trying to convince themselves because they know it's going against their spirit.
Yeah, that's right.
And so they're having to really be adamant to override what their spirit is trying to check them on. If you've got to be overly vocal to convince others, it's not faith. Because that's not confession. See, that's not confession. Well, praise the Lord. A little quieter than here than last night. To move ahead without having God's mind, the only thing you're left with is your mind. And that's scary. That's to have the disadvantage.
Yes.
That when the only thing you've got going with you on this journey is your mind, you're at the disadvantage. If you don't have what God said on it, what you heard God say, who's is that? Is that? But I didn't know if I was talking to Siri. You know how Siri, how many times have you said something to somebody and Siri answers you? It's like, so we have to make sure that we are not leaving God's mind back here and our mind moving forward. It's scary to think that all we've got in this is us. But without hearing, all you have is you. All you have is you. David whipped Goliath on that principle alone. He said, you are an uncircumcised Philistine. You're big, but you're standing out here alone. You got no God backing you up. You got no covenant backing you up. I might be little, but I'm not out here alone. I've got God of my covenant backing me up. See, and he won based on that. When we hear, we're not facing any opposition alone. We're facing that opposition with what God said, and we tell that opposition what God said. It won't do you any good to know what God says and not tell the opposition what God says. You have to tell opposition what God said to you. There have been so many times, especially, and I refer back to the projects after Ed went home because it was daily. It was a concentrated year of hearing from God and seeing that play out. And it was a very spectacular year in that sense. So forgive me, that's why I keep going back to that, because it was prominent. It was very prominent. The hearing was so prominent. And I can't tell you the number of times I would have a sense in my heart. I knew what to do. I heard it clear in here. I didn't just hear words. It was a knowing. It was the spirit that that bears witness. And that's enough to move on. And so I would make a decision, make steps in line with what God was directing me to do regarding a business decision. And the devil would bombard my mind and say, that's not going to work right. You're going to put yourself in all kinds of trouble. And I'd say, God said, God said, God said, God said, God said. What am I doing? I'm telling the opposition what God said. If you don't hear first, you can't answer that way.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
You got to hear first. Amen. Faith comes by hearing. Faith to do. Faith to do comes from hearing what he said to do. that which belongs to us in our redemption package, healing,
sure.
prosperity,
sure.
wisdom,
yes.
revelation, all these things that belong to us in our redemption package, I don't just randomly grab a verse.
No.
If I'm faced with something physical, I don't just randomly grab a verse. I want to hear what the Spirit, what verse the Spirit gives me, because there's life in that one.
Amen.
When He breathes on it, it's spendable.
Yeah.
When it's just your mind grabbing it, it's not spendable the same way. And then you just feel like you're just stuck and you're spinning that wheel but going nowhere. So I'm talking about, even if I'm just believing, the money comes. I always look here. What's the Spirit directing me to say on this? Even though I know prosperity scriptures, I don't want to mentally, randomly grab one. I want to hear. And the hearing doesn't mean take this verse and Isaac. No, I'm not talking. Your Spirit of God bearing witness with you. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. Praise the Lord. Dad Hagen was slow to make decisions, not because he was slow, but because he was skillful. I am slow in making decisions. And I'm doing it. And I'm not talking about obeying God. I'm talking about decisions that involve more than me. When it involves more than you, you just can't be flippant about it. You're mindful. Somebody else is affected by this. And I'm not going to carelessly just move ahead by faith. Because until you heard, you got no faith to move ahead. I'm a faith person. You got no faith to move ahead on that situation till you've heard.
Amen.
For example, when God started opening doors for different television networks, that I don't have it in my heart to shop it.
Yeah, right.
I had a precious minister ask me, he said, do you have a staff member that shops this stuff for you? I go, I don't know what you mean. And he said, well, because sometimes they'll assign a staff because God's told them to go on TV and they'll shop their best options. I said, no, I just let God bring it. I'm not saying it's wrong to shop it, because God might have said, he might say to somebody, get on. God said, what was it? And like in the 70s or 80s, Brother Copeland, like, get on 500 radio stations. He intended them to shop it. But for me, the way God's led. See, I can't take how God led somebody else and adopt that. How God's telling me, they just come. And just because they come, I don't assume God sent it. I've had people offer me free airtime. And I don't just accept it because it's free. Because you don't know what that connects you to. Because free time to the wrong connection is not free. That's going to hurt and take you off course at some point by being wrongly connected to something that was free. And I don't just take something because it's offered. I hear. I hear. Am I perfect at it? No, but I guarantee you what, if I take more time, I'm far closer to perfect than missing it. Amen. One person that I prize reading after is George Mueller. Because of what he built. He said, I would sense God is dealing with me about starting an orphanage. And then he built multiple buildings. If you've seen his compounds, you know, of multiple buildings, pictures of it. And he didn't assume that just because he already had one orphanage building that it was a no-brainer to just do a second one. If you ever treat something like a no-brainer, you're the one with a no-brainer.
Very good.
Because when we decide, we can dismiss him by saying this is a no-brainer. It's scary to get that pattern. And he said he would take that before the Lord, and he said, I would wait on it for weeks, months sometimes, until I had it clear in my spirit.
Praise God.
And that's the example that people have to have. Because you don't arrive at fulfillment of the plan of God without skill. And it's the skill of hearing. Amen. Psalm 127, turn with me. Psalm 127. Verse 1, Dad Hagen had this as his keynote scripture for his ministry. We have the same one for our ministry. Psalm 127, verse 1, except the Lord build. Except the Lord build. Except the Lord build. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. If he's not building it, vain labor is all that's left to build it. And I don't want anything he didn't build. Because it won't be a blessing. Then I want to, just let me read this out of Ephesians chapter 1, 23. This is the Amplified Classic Translation, the last phrase. Him who makes everything complete and who fills everything everywhere with himself. Now listen to that. Him who makes everything complete and who fills everything everywhere with himself. What's that mean? He'll build it and then he'll fill it with himself. Pastors, let God build your church. And he'll fill it with himself. But if you built it, you're not sure what is, you're going to be, it's going to be filled with something natural. A traveling minister, a ministry, let God build it. A business, let God build it. What's that mean? Hear what he says.
Yes.
Hear what he says and build it according to what he says to do.
Yes.
Now turn with me, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 19. Proverbs chapter 19. Listen, in the last days, accuracy is always meant much. But even in the last days, it will really compound the outcome of things. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 2, King James translation. Also, that the soul should be without knowledge, it is not good. And he that hasteth with his feet sinneth. The Living Bible, just listen to how the Living Bible reads. It is dangerous and sinful to rush into the unknown. You say, well, faith is moving into the unknown. No, when you have faith, you've heard something.
Right.
It's not unknown. It's not unknown because you heard what God said. And what God said gives you your directive of moving forward. Verse 3. The Living Bible, Proverbs 19, verse 3. This is the Living Bible. A man may ruin his chances by his own foolishness and then blame it on the Lord. Proverbs 19, verse 2, the Amplified Classic. Desire without knowledge is not good. And to be over hasty is to sin and miss the mark. What's he saying? To go too fast becomes a sin in some situations. It's not skill to go too fast.
Yeah, it's good.
People think, boy, I'm proficient at this. Here it says it's a sin to go too fast.
Wow.
It's not just inconvenient to go too fast. It's a sin. Why? Because it's expensive to miss God. It's expensive. Amen. Speedy decisions. Speedy decision making is not something to be prized. Hearing is what's to be prized. I don't mind. I don't stand back. You know, some people don't like decision making. That's not ever frightened me. You know, I don't have a problem making decisions. But even more so when you hear, there's no risk.
Right. Right. Yes.
There's no risk.
Yes.
The risk is in making a decision when you haven't heard. Now, if decisions and moves are made without clarity of what God says, you have no defense against opposition that's going to show up because you don't have an answer. Why am I doing this? Because God said.
Yes.
But if you don't know what God said, when the devil opposes, you have, you might come up with an answer, but it doesn't work the same. When God delivered the Hebrews out of Egypt, I have a land I've given you. I've given you this, a land flows with milk and honey. All they had to do was just keep walking and saying that. Keep walking and saying what God said. But they wouldn't say what God said, so they never arrived.
Right.
And the only two that arrived, of the next generation, arrived because of one thing. They kept saying what God said. But what if you don't know what God's saying? If you didn't hear, how do you arrive? What he says is the arrival to things. Now, I don't want to, if I could say this, take the wind out of people by saying this, because we can all look back and say, oh, I can look back on my life and I can see steps I made, directions I took, and I didn't hear. I thought I was doing really good. God is able to help us out of the wrong place if we'll recognize we got there because we didn't hear. Instead of keep trying to make it work. Just keep trying to make it work and then calling it faith. If you didn't hear, you don't have any grounds for faith. The grounds for faith is hearing. Smith Wigglesworth tells about the time somebody was selling a home, and Smith Wigglesworth said it looked to him like a great move. And he says, I'll buy it. Back then, your word was your bond.
Yes. Right.
So if you said it verbally, you were bound.
Yes, you were.
And he went to God about it, and God said, I never told you that. And now he's bound. He's got to pay the money at a certain date, and he didn't have the money, and he didn't have the word.
Right.
He had the word. He wasn't even supposed to buy it.
Right.
And he says, I went to family members. I went to friends. I asked everybody for the money, and it all was no. They didn't have it. And he said, I went to God, and I said, God, I need you to help me out of this. And he said, okay, here's what to do.
Wow.
Praise God.
Now, if you don't realize that you got there because you didn't hear, you have to acknowledge, I got here because I didn't hear. And it's more important now. The way to get out of this is hearing.
Uh-huh.
The way to get out of where you shouldn't be is hearing. And he is so good to you and to me. He will always give us something to hear to get us out. But if you don't recognize it was lack of hearing, because see, if you don't recognize that, you won't listen to hear to get out. God will allow you to do what you planned to show you it doesn't work.
Wow.
He'll allow you to start a church. He'll allow you to start a ministry. He'll allow you to start a business. If he didn't say it, he'll allow you to do it to show you it doesn't work without hearing. And I don't want to learn that way. And we've all probably learned a little bit that way, to a measure.
Amen.
And if he said it, it would have worked. If you'd have hold to what he said. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Even in believing for miracles for people. Loved ones. People. That ask you to minister to them, believe with them. don't just set your faith with them without hearing something. I'm thinking of someone that I know really well, and they contacted me, and they had a very serious situation. Life, a death sentence over their head physically. And they were young. And I got to have something when I agree. I got to have a hook.
Right.
Yeah. I got to be able to hook onto something. So I went to pray, and I'm praying for them. I'm calling them out before God, and God, and I hear this. He calls their name, and he says, set your house in order. That's all I can believe for. That's all I can believe for. I can't believe for healing when I didn't hear. When I heard, set your house in order. But you know what I did do? I said, now, God, I hear what you said. I believe what you said. I believe it. I'm not arguing with you. But that was said to Hezekiah, and he didn't set his house in order out here. He set his house in order in here. He set this house in order. And he turned toward the wall. Before the prophet even got off the grounds, the word of the Lord said, I'm going to add 15 years. Go back and tell him. And I said, so I'm going to ask you. When you say set your, and called their name, set your house in order, could this house still be set in order? But I knew they weren't recognizing that this needed to be in order. And there was no hook. I couldn't hook on. I couldn't hook on. What's that mean? I don't just randomly start throwing what I call faith at something, because you can't throw faith when you haven't heard. And you will injure your faith walk. You'll get disillusioned. Well, I thought, you know, the word's not working. No, you have to hear. Faith comes by hearing. You can't confess without hearing something. I mean, effectively confess. And people start losing confidence in their faith walk, in their faith life, when they just randomly grab verses and start throwing, and then nothing happens, and they go, they lose confidence. And that is so injuring to your walk with God. Here. Here. I wanted to agree with that person and say, come on, I'll stand with you. But I couldn't, I could not offer them that till I heard something. And I went to God, what do you say about this? That it called their name, set your house in order. And they went home to be with the Lord. But see, it didn't injure my faith because I already heard. And I can't force God to say what I want to hear. And if you think you're going to take your prayer life and force God to say what you want to hear, you will move out of the perfect will of God. You'll move into the permissive will of God, because he'll permit you to do anything you want. It is quieter in here tonight. It is quieter. Hallelujah. Proverbs 19, verse 21, the Amplified Classic Translation. Proverbs 19, 21, Amplified Classic Translation. Many plans are in a man's mind, but it is the Lord's purpose for him that will stand. What's that mean? The many plans won't stand. But God's purpose has the stuff to stand. But the mind, the planning of man's mind doesn't have the stuff to stand, because it's void of what God says.
Amen.
So pastors, just get with God and hear what he has for your church. And don't run around trying to copycat.
That's right.
and trying to hear it from out here, because you won't have faith for anything you hear a man say about the steps of success he took. You won't have any faith for that. You have to hear from God. Faith comes from hearing what God says, not from hearing what a successful minister said. You have to hear from God. You have to hear from God. Don't bypass that hearing. Matthew, then we'll close with this. Matthew 13, verse 10. Matthew 13, verse 10. I just want you to see the reward of waiting to hear. Waiting long enough to hear. Because it removes all the struggle when you have God's words to spend. Yeah. Matthew 13, verse 10. This is the King James. And the disciples came and said to Jesus, "Why speakest thou unto them in parables?" And he answered and said unto them, "Because it's given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given. And from him shall be taken away even, and whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that he hath." What's he talking about? Who has what? Who has ears to hear? When you have ears to hear, you'll receive more. When you don't have ears to hear, even what you have will be taken from you. Verse 13, "Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not, and hearing they hear not." I don't want to be the congregation member that's sitting and hearing and hear not. Hearing the preacher, hearing the pastor, hearing the sermon, and hear not. They were hearing Jesus, but Jesus said, "They're hearing me, but they hear not." Their spiritual aptitude, so to speak, they're not taking it in. Isn't that something to hear Jesus and still don't hear it? Mm-hmm. He said, "So hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and shall not perceive." Why is that? Verse 15 tells us why. "For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes," look at this, "they have closed." Our hearing is up to us, not up to God. It's up to us. It's up to us. It's up to us. If we grow dull of hearing, how do we move ahead? How do we have faith? We have to stay so sensitive, so tender. Keep your heart tender. 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 If you miss it, well, we've all missed it. But acknowledge, go to God and say, "I missed it." Why? Because now you have held dullness off of you. And it's dangerous to be dull. It's dangerous to be dull. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Well, stand with me to your feet. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. I'm so grateful that we get to hear these things. Probably about, I don't know, a week or so ago, God said, "This is what I want you to minister on." He's prescribed it for us. Yes. That we can follow him into fixing anything, and then now we can move ahead in skill when we understand this. I prize hearing. 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 Father, we thank you tonight. We glorify you. We magnify you. I magnify you. Magnify you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Worship you, Jesus.
worship you, Jesus. Just lift up your hands and lift up your voice to him. We worship you, Father. We worship you, Father. We worship you. We worship you.
This is a known song, but I'm going to change one line. We usually don't sing this unless it's an altar call, but it's all to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. This is the part I want to change. I will listen, I will follow in his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee.
If you're in a direction that just seems hard, no matter what you do, it's a struggle. It's a struggle. That's an invitation to hear. It's an invitation to hear. Hearing removes the struggle when you walk in line with what you hear. And don't just keep forging ahead and I'm just going to keep going. Why keep going without knowing? Why keep going without knowing what he said to you? You know, Abraham, it talks about Abraham in Hebrews, and the Amplified Classic Translation said, he went although he didn't know where he was to go. He didn't trouble his mind about it. Why? Because he already had what God said to him. He didn't know every day in advance, but he had the word. I've given you a land, Abraham. Leave your family. And so he was following that. So even though he didn't know the details of it ahead, he still had that word.
that gave him the faith to just keep moving undisturbed. So if you're disturbed, go back and get the words you need to hear so you can go undisturbed. Not keep doing what you're doing, but willing to hear if you need to change course, change direction. Well, I don't back up. Faith never backs up. If you didn't hear, you're not in faith. Because faith comes by hearing. And it's always right to back up, to get in step with what God said. Jesus told Dad Hagen on one occasion, he said, I would rather you move too slow than too fast. He said, because if you get out ahead of me, you can no longer see me leading. But if you fall behind, at least you can still see where I'm leading. It's like if you took your kid, a small child, to Disneyland, and they get excited about everything they see, they want it all now, and they just take off running a direction. If they get out in front of you, they have no idea if you make a turn. But if they get behind you and they're lagging behind, they can still, oh, Dad went this direction, Mom went this direction. Too slow is better than too fast. Too slow is better than too fast. But as we learn, we can just keep pace and just keep at exact pace. But while you're learning, don't learn in the fast direction, learn in the slow direction. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Learn on being slow, don't learn on being too fast. And then as you become more skillful, you can just keep pace. And we're all learning. I said we're all learning. And don't let the accuser or the brethren accuse you, because he's always acting by not hearing. Don't take counsel from him about how you failed, because no one's failed like he's failed. No one. No being in creation has ever failed like he's failed. So the key, though, is not to just keep pressing through. If you have words, keep pressing through. If you don't have words, you're going to have to get words. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We praise you, Father. We praise you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. Hallelujah. Pastor Debbie, would you hand me that mic right there, please? Pastor Noel, do you have something? You got anything? Come on up. Come up here so they can see you, if you would.
Yes, Santos. Yes, yeah. Yes, I will say it, Lord. They that wait, mm-hmm. not in a hurry, wait. Mm-hmm. They that wait upon the Lord, they that wait upon what he will say, you will run mm-hmm. and not be weary. You will walk and not faint. You will always have joy. You will always have peace. And your steps will always be right. Yeah, Musu. Yeah, Kutos. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, glory. Oh, Masike, Tukos Test. Yeah, yeah. His wisdom will be poured out. His wisdom will be poured out to those that wait. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, kaposh, kapuhoya. Yes, it is. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, you will not walk in darkness. Yeah, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Yeah, the Holy Ghost is the voice behind that hearing.
Yes.
Yeah, wait for him. Oh, yeah, yeah. Aha, uh-huh, yeah, yeah. Because What you hear from him is life. What you hear from him is life.
Yeah.
Yeah. What you hear from the Holy Ghost, it brings life to you. It brings life to you. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. 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 Yeah. In ministry, in finances, in your body, in every area of your life, in your family. They that wait, yes, yes, life, life, the life of God. The life of God will flow in every area of your life. Yeah? Mm-hmm. What you hear, what you hear, what you hear, what you hear from God is life, is life. Yeah, 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 yeah. Not just natural life, it's eternal life. It's eternal life. It's eternal life. Knowing the Father, knowing the Word, knowing the Lord Jesus Christ is eternal life. Oh, yes, yes, you will walk and enjoy your life. You will walk and enjoy the life that God already had prepared for you before the world was. Yeah, it's already been prepared. It's prepared by God. It's prepared by the Father to those that love Him. Now here, 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 because He's speaking the Word to us. This is time. This is time. This is the very hour. This is the very moment. Oh, oh yeah, because of the finish. Because of the finish of the time. Ah, kosokoto. Yes, ekitisoto. Yeah. Oh yes, 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 yes. Oh yes. Oh yes. Yes, 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 yes. Oh yes. Oh yeah, yeah. Yes, logosuko. Aho, aho. Oh, yes, 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 yes. It's not too late. It's not too late. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Forget the past. Oh, forget the past mistake. Forget the wrong decisions. But it's still time. There's still time. Oh, yako. Ha. Yakoto so. All you need is to hear. All you need is to hear. All you need is wait on the Holy Ghost. Yeah, yeah. Oh, because He knows the mind of the Father. And He will reveal them unto you. Akoto sukata. Yakato soko. Akato soko. Nakato soko. Hakato soko.
Can I tell you this? Hearing unravels complicated situations. When you think it's so involved, there's so many layers and so many problems, one hearing one thing unravels everything. Yeah, right? Father, we thank you. We thank you. Let's just lift up the things of our life that we say, I may need to look at that. Mm-hmm. Father, we lift up your plan, that we know your plan. Your plan. Your plan. Nama mama chaga da basa ta cho 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 ko 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 ye mas to osto ko 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 ya aza da da di di ki ki ye anja ta posto de di esti mancha asta ki ki ye mancha asta ta asta ta ta asta ta ta asta ka ya da posto ria da basa ka 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 ya da posto de pe ki 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 ye mas da to to ye asta to to ye Great strides ahead. Great strides ahead. Hata gakakaye. Ah, papa, papa, chaka. Ah, sototo. Ete estiki. Osh ata, astata, ostompa, astata, tututu, kokokoye. Ma, zododododo, kokokoye. Mancha, tototo, kokokoye. As do to tokoye. Masato cho to ko te kikikia. Azo do 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 shtikikie. Ampapa, ampapa, Papa, Master Tokokoye, Master Kakakaye de Besiki Kiye, Master Tokoko de Besiki Kikiya de Boson Chikikiye, Major Dodo Boshoko de Kikiye, Baba Kastakari Yatapokoye, Sototoshti Esti, Esti Chiki, Esti Tikiye. Maza do kokoye, maza do kokokoye, maza da kakakaya da boso kokokoye, maza do koshti kikiye, maza do koshti kikiye, maza ta kaya da boso to koye, maza ta. Now let me say this to you: waiting on the Lord involves several things. Number one, worship. Number two is word. Number three, praying. And I mean primarily in the spirit. Don't spend all your time praying in the spirit. Leave out the word. You'll get off. And what you hear won't be God always. Because you can get out beyond your ability, beyond your knowledge of the word and get duped. And some have done that. They've prayed so much in tongues and they've left out the word. And they get duped and they become unsound. And they start hearing things and calling it God, and it confuses them because what they're calling God is troubling their life. Yes. Yes. Amen. Yeah. When waiting on the Lord involves spending time worshiping, in the word, praying in other tongues. I don't want to assume that we're all in here. Are you in here tonight? You're born again, but you're not filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. You need the divine help of God talk. Divine utterance. Cooperating. Is anybody in here? Raise your hand real high if you say, I'm born again, but I am not filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. I don't know that there's anybody here, but I don't want to assume or presume because you need this divine help. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, good. Employ it. Yes. Employ it. Amen. Father, we thank you. We thank you. Mashtikaya da besikikiye. Ashtikikiya da bosoria da mantai. Ambaria da bosto to kokokoya da basatatatakaye. Ma papa. You say, Pastor Nancy, how long do I have to wait? It depends on how loud your life is. It may take some real time for some people's mind to calm down, quiet down, so that they can hear and get their bodies out of that flow of just push, 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 and calling that faith. It may take it's going to be different for everybody based on their ability to shut down what's loud so that they can hear. Amen. And there's a skill involved in that. We praise you, Father. Mashtikiya da boso boshtikikiye. Ampaparia da basaki. Cindy, Miss Cindy, you got something. Well, I don't know. It might be something to say, not necessarily something to sing. Just whatever.
Jesus, let's just lift up our hands. Father, we thank you. Mashtikakaka. And out of your inner being will flow rivers of living water. Rivers imbroboshekele eregese. Rivers improvoso sikele legesta. And there will be a divine supernatural flow of the Holy Ghost that will lead and guide you into all truth. Some things that you know and some things you don't know, but the Spirit, there will be a flow. So step into that flow and step into the guide and step in and follow imbreboshekele engregeso sombreva. Because the flow is so divine. Divine irabasca. Divine impreveso sida. Divine impregisto sara. And so on in the mishke. Ah, sam bon jesi grezira sera. Out of your inner being, boshese gria sara. Oh, boshese. Anamanania. And there'll be a flow. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. There is a flow of the mighty Holy Ghost. There is a prayer that we lift unto the Lord. A prayer of faith, a prayer of divine flow. It's time to stand in His precious presence. That flow divine flows, oh, when Him we reverence. So we lift our hearts, we yield our lives unto the Lord. A divine flow of the presence of the Lord. The presence of the Lord. So we worship, so we listen, so we meditate His word. So we worship and we listen and we do the things we've heard. So we enter in tonight. Oh, not just stand and say, well, that is very nice, but we begin to worship, begin to magnify, begin to worship the Lord. Oh, we begin to worship, begin to magnify, begin to lift up and praise the Lord. Yes, we do. We worship. Oh, we worship. Oh, we worship. And then we flow with the mighty Holy Ghost. And then we sing praises to our King. And then we're led by His Spirit, we are led. Divine flow of the mighty Holy Ghost. Oh, thank You, Jesus. Come on, a divine flow. Oh, Lord, we worship, we worship, we worship. Come on, we lift our voice, we worship. Praise God, we worship. We worship, we worship, we worship, we worship, we worship. Oh, I just heard the Holy Ghost say so sweet, you don't have to worry that you're gonna miss Me. When you begin to speak, when you set your eyes on Me, when you begin to worship and begin to get in My presence, and in My presence there's a divine flow. In My presence you will know. In My presence you'll step in and see. And in My presence, as you seek Me, you will see. Ah. Ha, 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 ha. I see. I see. I see. This isn't difficult for Me. I just step in and see. Oh, hallelujah to My King. Hallelujah to the One who knows everything. Hallelujah for the divine flow. Hallelujah. Oh, we lift our voice. 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 Oh, we lift our voice to You, oh Lord. Hallelujah. In Your presence, I know. Oh, let's lift our hands and just thank Him. Hallelujah.
Praise.
When your heart is so sincere and hungry to please God, if you're not careful, the enemy would like to take that and make you fearful of missing Him.
Yes.
That's, he'll play on your sincerity and use it against you.
Yes.
In the sense of people become afraid of missing Him.
Yes.
Don't worry. You don't worry your way into the plan. You hear your way. You just hear your way. So that's one of the things that you may have to recognize is the fear of missing God, the fear of doing it wrong. And you have to have the skill to recognize that's not going to push me, not going to drive me, and color it to where now there's a sense of dread over my life. Amen. Father, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. Praise the Lord. Brother Joel, if you'd come up here with me, then I'm going to have the ministers. If you're full-time fivefold ministry, and pastors traveling, whatever, there's impartations for us, amen. Because it matters that we're so accurate because of what's connected to that which God entrusts to us, the congregations and the people, amen. So full-time fivefold ministry, and you would like us to bless you, just lay hands and impart. You're welcome to come up. Master God bless you. So easy. That higher flow. So easy to step in and go. Ha ha ha. Mataye. Anstanta. Yes, it is easy. Yes, it is. Asatata. Asta kakaye. Help her back up, would you? Help her back up. Those things that others did not have proper regard for, entrusted to you. Every step set like in concrete, so certain of the step. Pastor Debbie, you will be so certain. It won't be like when you take a step, it'll shift under your foot. It'll be so firm under your foot because it's accurate. Accurate steps are so firm. Ha ha shtikiye. Mas da 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 go 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 ya da bas da da tikiye. Recovering all. Don't allow anything unrecovered. You know what I'm talking about? With our conversations that you had just shared, that's what everything recovered and multiplied. Everything recovered and multiplied. Hasta kakakaya de bestikikiye. Master astikikiya de bosoto toye. Aza the koshtikikiye. Mancha tatatoto kostiki kiki atabasti esti. Acha tatataya. Further grace for Fresno. Ha ha. Further grace. It's a further grace than what you walked in Fireball. Fresno has a further grace for it. Mastaka kakaya da bosto korya da bashtikiki. Etebesi ampacha da da do estikiki ya da bosso kokokoye. Ampapapashti estikiki ada mosso do 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 mosso ne me 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 ki hana manta. Mastikiki ya da bosti estikiki ya estikiki ye. As do 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 ko 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 ye. Full recovery is in hearing. Full recovery is in hearing. In every arena, every arena, every arena. Mas nikiki ana mantaya ostoye. Ah cha ta 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 to ko 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 ye. As to ko 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 ye tapash nikiki ye. Mas do 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 monas tombe e shikiki ki ye. Mas do 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 costo ko de tiki. Impartations into others in a far greater measure. So do it, do it, do it, do it, do it, do it. Hastakaye, call for it in your services, Miss Cindy. Call for it. Master Azda Kakakaya the Bosto Kokokoye. Master Kiki Yana Mancha Kakakaye. Papa chakaka yana monto toto ya de besti kiki ya de besti kiki ya de besti kiki ya de bosto koye. Master kakaka ya de bosto to choko koye. Papa papa kasto koko koye. Na papa papa chaka de besti kiki ya. Master osto osto chi esti esti. Papa papa chahata. Baba kasto koko koko koye de besti kiki ya. Master esti kiki ya. I don't know what this is about, Stephen, but something about, just as you would see the levels of something rise, you go to fill it up and you see there's something that's rising, but it's not quite there yet. And I don't know what that's pertaining to, but when it hits full, you'll see something. It'll be an obvious, dramatic change. And I don't know what that's relating to. But we praise you, Father. Pastor. I remember when my husband and I got married, and God said to me, two can run so much faster and farther than one. You know, that's why God linked us together. But it's the same thing with your divine connection. Whoever that is, wherever that is, that connection will speed you along. It'll be divine acceleration with something with that connection. And I don't know whether it's recognized or fortified. I don't know what it is, but something, when there's something that is settled with that and set firm with that, it will be like the turbo on an engine just taking off. That's the only thing that has seemed to be And the blessing of God has been apparent. The blessing of God, the call of God. But when there's just, and it will just be like, I had no idea it could be this dramatic in the change of it. So we thank you, Father, for making that known to him. Ah, has to go. Ma, shtiki ki, ya the bosto koko ko, ya the bestiki ki, ya namasta ye. Asta ka ka ka, ya the bosto, ya the bestiki ki ye. Ancha kata posto koriki kiki ya da posto koko koye ya ta pasta kake ye. Ambabababa kashiki ye. Just make sure you keep it all in his hands. Every arena, everything that tries to trouble, everything that tries to sit on you, get it out of your hands. Get it out of your hands, because when it's not in your hands, it can't sit on you. And it can't sit on him. So make sure, whatever it is, the different arenas, where personal ministry, make sure it's just in his hands. And you know whether or not it's in if you know if something is in your hands, if it's trying to sit on you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Father. Fresh instruction coming. Fresh direction coming. Fresh instruction coming. Pastor, there's a whole nother layer of ministry, a whole nother adding and enlarging of something you've already tasted of, but it's going to be enlarged and compounded. We thank you for it, Father. Pray it out in the spirit. Hearing is easy in that place. Because of the faithful serving, there's going to be things that are going to show up. There are going to be things, and you're going to say, I don't know what I did to warrant this. Serving warranted that. We thank you, Father. Go home. Line up your children and put your hands on them. And there's something God has for them. There's something God has for them. The rewards and the blessing of being willing to carry on the work. God appreciates it. He appreciates that you are willing to step into something that would have been easier to just start over. But you didn't cast aside what had been sown, and he appreciates that you took the route that called for your faith in a whole nother measure, a whole nother degree, and he appreciates it. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Master, come here, Brother Joel. Let's lay hands on. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you for wholeness. We thank you. We thank you, Father. We thank you. We thank you for that anointing that destroys the yoke. We thank you for it. We thank you for it. We thank you, 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 we thank you for the refreshing. We thank you for the refreshing. We thank you for the refreshing of our spirit, the refreshing of our faith, the refreshing. The bastigigia, the bustoja is digigia, the bustoja. We thank you for it, Father. David, this year, I don't know if you've ever picked up like a pamphlet and it just looks like it's going to open normal, but every time you open it, there's another fold and it just keeps getting bigger. That's what this year is going to be, an unfolding of the things you've been holding up before God, and then it's going to just be laid out clear and you'll see it. So it's one fold at a time. It's not jerking the whole thing because then you tear it, you know? But if you open it properly, then it's one fold at a time, and then before long the whole thing's laid out. This year. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Because it's been unfolding, but it's a fold at a time. But now you pick up a magazine and they're going to do with you. It's a spread. It's a spread, right? You're going to see the spread. We thank you for it, Father. If you came tonight for this purpose, to have hands laid on you, for any physical condition, you came for that purpose. We want to take time to minister to you before we're dismissed. Now, this is not just a general healing call. This is for you came specifically because we know that people watch the Jesus the Healer broadcast and they're longing to be ministered to. And we want to give place to that tonight. Anybody at all? Hallelujah. Before we close down. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Yeah, let's just sing some. Just whatever.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Jesus, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We receive help tonight that shows us how to walk accurately. And if adjustments need to be made, we heard how to do it. So we make those adjustments. And no fear, no worry. Just peace and joy. Casting our care on you and running the fullness of the plan. We thank you for it, Father. We thank you for it. Hallelujah. Well, the Lord is good. I said, the Lord is good. You don't want to miss tomorrow morning. Wasn't this morning so good, Pastor Noel? Thank you. We come out of here speaking Filipino. And so we got more tomorrow, and then, of course, tomorrow night. Turn to somebody before you're dismissed and say this: God is good to me all the time. And you can be dismissed.